Hello, Patrick Walchuk here with the agentinottawa.com team, and I'm sitting here with Marc Menard of the ottawamortgageshop.com, and Marc is a mortgage broker, and what we want to do is have a discussion about the current state of the mortgage market in Ottawa, and I'll ask him some questions that are hopefully some of the same questions that you might have when you're talking to a mortgage person. So starting off, Marc, what are the current rates, if you could maybe give me a variable 3 and 5 year rates right now?
Sure, yeah, that's absolutely something I can give you. So the variable rates, 3 and 5 years, is typically what's offered by the banks and lenders. However, the 3 year is something that's kind of gone the way of the wayside, so there's not too many lenders offering that. However, that being said, the 3 and the 5 year basically have the same rates. So typically it's going to be bank prime, which is currently at 2.45%, minus a discount of about 1.10, so which would bring your rate down right now to about 1.35 on the variable.
1.35, wow, that's an amazing rate. So if you're meeting with a buyer right now, would you advise them to lock in or just sit on a variable?
Well, right now I would probably advise to lock in. The reason being is that rates are slowly going up. So there is an ascent there. It's not super quick as it's been in the past. However, it is happening. The economy is getting better slowly but surely. Hopefully COVID is leaving us a little bit. So rates are currently very close to their all-time lows. And I would think it's a good time to lock in at this point.
Okay. And when you look into your crystal ball,
yes,
where do you think rates might be in a year or two from now?
I wish I had that crystal ball, but so this is going to be pure speculation. But the way things are going right now, I'd say we had an increase of about 0.5% here in the last month or so.
Wow.
So it is going up, but they were so low, they had nowhere to go but up. My crystal ball, if I was to guess, would say that we're going to be looking at probably somewhere between 0.5 to 0.75 points higher than where we are right now in a year. But it's a crystal ball I don't have.
Right. Okay, so let's just round that off to, let's say, a 1% increase.
Sure.
Okay. So if somebody had a $500,000 mortgage,
yep,
what's the difference between the rate they get now versus if they hold off a year from now and they have to pay an extra 1%? So
yeah,
a 500 mortgage, how much more would that be?
On a $500,000 mortgage, you'd be looking at approximately $250 more a month as far as your payments are concerned. So if you want to annualize that, we're looking at what, roughly $2,500 a year more in mortgage payments. If that's over a course of a 5 year mortgage, you know, we're getting close to the $10,000 mark. So it's significant. So, you know, there is some value in locking in now if that's an option. Obviously, crystal ball that we don't have, but it's looking like it would be a good option.
And that word significant, I think, is very true, because that money that they're basically leaving on the table by not locking in now, that additional money could be used to help pay down the principal even more.
Exactly. Yeah,
okay,
absolutely.
So terrific. Now, when you're dealing with a buyer, and you're pre-approving them so they can submit an offer on a property with a very short financing condition, or maybe no financing condition at all, what are the absolutely critical things that you tell the buyer that you need to get from them? What do? You do a credit check? What documents do you need? Like, tell me about that so any buyers watching this, you can be prepared to make a more solid offer. So
yes, absolutely. So no financing conditions, as Patrick would definitely know, is a very real reality right now on most deals, I would say. So the way we're doing pre-approvals is the same way we would have done an approval in the past. So collecting all the documents, collecting a credit file, so pulling a credit bureau, unless a client is absolutely certain about what is on his credit file and can guarantee that his credit rating is in good shape. And then we're running it through our application, making sure that the numbers work, including the property taxes specific to the property, condo fees if they apply, and all those types of things. And so basically, you're going in, making an offer, knowing you're approved if your offer gets approved.
So when you say pulling the credit file, you go to a place like TransUnion or Equifax.
That's correct.
And does that cost the purchaser anything?
No, there's no cost to the purchaser whatsoever when it comes to pulling a credit file. That cost is absorbed by either the lender or us as mortgage providers.
Terrific. Okay, that's great to know. Now, a certain segment of the market, obviously, are condo purchases. So if you're meeting with somebody and they want to buy a condo, is that approval different than a freehold property?
It's different, but similar in the same way. The only difference with a condo is that we're going to have to factor in the condo fees. So, for example, if the condo fees are $500 a month on the said property, we add that to the application, which is then calculated at 50%. So, basically, we're adding $250 of needing to qualify for. So, the way you qualify for a mortgage, just to keep it real simple, Mortgage 101, is a calculation called Total Debt Servicing Ratio. So, what that is that's going to be your mortgage payment calculated at 4.79, which is what the stress test is, along with estimated heating costs, property taxes, condo fees, and then whatever liabilities you might have on your credit file, such as lines of credits, car payments. All those things put in together have to represent less than 44% of your gross income. Therefore, the condo fee is something we need to know about.
Okay. If you had somebody looking at a condo and because the condo fees can vary so dramatically, would you be able to tell a purchaser that you can afford a condo of $400,000 if the fees are this much?
Yeah.
But if the fees are $800, which is more than another one, can you tell them how much of a condo and how much of condo fee that they will qualify for?
Yes, absolutely. So the way we typically do it at the Ottawa Mortgage Shop is that basically I'm going to get your pre-approval based on no condo fee. So let's just say hypothetically you qualify for $800,000 as a mortgage, but now you go see a property that has $800 in condo fees. So what we do is about every $100 worth of condo fees is about $10,000 less in qualifying. So in this case here, $800 in condo fees means you qualify for $80,000 less than what
you would. Repeat that last part about the amount of condo fees is...
Yeah, about $10,000, about $100 of condo fees is worth $10,000 in approval.
Great rule of thumb. Thank you for that.
No problem.
Okay, now, when you, the buyer, are ready to submit an offer, and there could be 5, 10, 30, 40 offers on a property, you get caught up in the frenzy, you submit your offer, you win the bidding war, and you pay, let's say, $500,000 for the property. Now, you have no conditions. What happens is the bank will send in an appraiser. So, Mark, what happens when the appraiser goes in and the buyer has purchased a property for $500,000 and it's appraised at only $475,000? It's appraised at $25,000 under what they paid for it. What happens then?
So, basically, in simple terms, the buyer has to come up with the difference of what the appraisal was versus what the purchase price was. So, in this case here, I think you said $500,000 and $475,000. The buyer would have to come up with an additional $25,000 in down payment to offset that difference, so that the bank is still lending on the same loan to value as what the property was appraised.
Ouch.
In this case, not too bad, $25,000, but it can be more, unfortunately. That, however, is only applicable if you need your full down payment. So let's just say, hypothetically, you're purchasing this house for $500,000, but you only need $250,000 in mortgage. So if the appraisal comes in at $475,000, it doesn't make a difference. In this case here, because you have $250,000 already of extra built into it.
Right, so that, from a bank's perspective, reduces the risk.
Exactly. So where it becomes a problem, if you will, is definitely on insured deals, so meaning anything less than 20%, insured by CMHC or others, and somebody who's just, basically using every dollar that they have in their savings to make the down payment because they need that to qualify. So in those types of cases, it's problematic.
Right, and if you're talking to somebody like Mark, be very aware of that, and maybe your strategy is to have X amount of dollars put on the side so that if you do get caught in that trap, you can pay that amount to the bank. In this case, our example of an additional $25,000. Couple of last things here.
Sure.
Mark, first one is bridge financing. In this current market, no seller will accept an offer that says this offer is conditional upon me selling my house, right?
Not a chance. Yeah.
So very frequently, a buyer will put an offer in on a property while they still own their current house. Yeah. knowing that it'll be fairly easy for them to sell their house. Now, the issue becomes the closing date on the property they purchased, and when they sell their house, the closing date on that one. And the individual can possibly end up owning two properties, and there's a thing called bridge finance.
That's right.
What can you tell me about that?
Well, bridge financing is not for people purchasing a bridge. What bridge financing is it's just basically a gap between the sale of your property and the purchase of a new one. So what the banks will do is they will, as long as you, so the first thing to know and the most important thing to know about bridge financing is that you have to have a firm sale on your house. Now, you might have bought a house on closing on July 1st, for example, and you've sold yours, but it doesn't close until July 21st. So there's a three-week difference there. But your house is sold without conditions. So the banks will consider it a sale. From there, they'll lend you what you need from equity in the sale of your house to put towards the down payment of the new one. They'll typically lend that at bank prime plus 1 or 2%, depends on the lenders. Sometimes there's a small fee. Most lenders will do 90 to 120 days of this bridge loan. But you don't want to get into something that long. It does get quite costly. So it's a wonderful tool for 2-3 weeks a month, or even people purposely do bridge loans to have an extra week of owning both houses so that you can move freely and easily and not have the stress of having to do everything on closing day.
Yeah.
So it's an option that's out there. It's, and most banks will have a maximum on how much a bridge loan can be. I looking up a little bit of the lenders we deal with, $200,000 seems to be where most banks fall.
You said something interesting, that the bridge loan is basically effective as long as the buyer has a firm sale to purchase and they've got a firm sale in their house.
That's right.
Firm is unconditional. What if they haven't sold their house yet? So they bought this other property firm and it's closing, I think your example was July 1st, for example.
Right.
So it's closing July 1st. They haven't sold their house yet. What happens then?
Well, if the approval, the mortgage approval, was approved on condition of your house being sold, this could be a very stressful time. For the simple fact that you haven't sold, therefore you don't have the down payment, and the banks won't do a bridge loan on a potential sale or a probable sale. They really want to see that there has been a sale that happened. So
ouch again
is right. Yes. This type of environment right now that we're in does have a few ouches for sure. Mm-hmm. But if you're well informed with people like Patrick and mortgage people like myself, we can help you avoid those ouches.
Okay, good to know. So that's basically all the questions I have for you.
Okay.
But you deal with buyers every day.
Yeah.
Do you have any final words of wisdom for the people watching?
Well, I don't know if I'd call them wisdom, but I think at this stage right now, in the market that we're in, it's extremely, extremely important to keep communications open with your realtor and your mortgage agent. We need to be in touch, myself and Patrick in this case, knowing exactly what the other hand is doing so that we make sure that there's none of these things that become a surprise. So be in communication, consistently run numbers with your mortgage specialist. So if you're going to see a different property that you originally did, this one has different property taxes, different condo fees, please let us know exactly what those are so we can make sure that when you're going in with an unconditional offer, it's being done in a smart manner.
Okay, very good. So that's a wrap on this. Again, I'm Patrick Walchuk, and if you have any mortgage questions, call Mark or contact him at Ottawa Mortgage Shop.